We were wanderers from the beginning. We were bounded only by the earth and the ocean and the sky. The frontier was everywhere. When the drought was prolonged, or when an unsettling chill lingered in the summer air, our group moved on. We sought a better place. We could always begin again. We were hunters and foragers. Wanderers on the savannas and the steppes. We knew every stand of tree for 100 miles. When the fruits or nuts were ripe, we were there. We depended on one another. Making it on our own was as ludicrous to imagine as was settling down. This zest to explore and exploit has clear survival value. It is an endowment that all members of the human species hold in common. It is not restricted to any one nation or ethnic group. Long before Columbus, Indonesian Argonauts in outrigger canoes explored the Western Pacific. Egyptians and Libyans circumnavigated Africa, and a great fleet of ocean-going junks from Ming Dynasty China crisscrossed the Indian Ocean, established a base in Zanzibar, rounded the Cape of Good Hope, and entered the Atlantic Ocean. We invest far-off places with a certain romance. The open road still softly calls. The appeal, I suspect, has been meticulously crafted by natural selection as an essential element in our survival. Long summers, mild winters, rich harvests, plentiful game, none of them lasts forever. Catastrophic events have a way of sneaking up on us, of catching us unaware. Your own life or your band's might be owed to a restless few, drawn by a craving they can hardly articulate or understand, to undiscovered lands and new worlds. Herman Melville in Moby Dick spoke for wanderers in all epochs and meridians. He said, "I am tormented with an everlasting itch for things remote. I love to sail forbidden seas."
We have a liftoff, 32 minutes past the hour. Liftoff on Apollo 11.
From this distant vantage point, the Earth might not seem of any particular interest. But for us, it's different. Consider again that dot. That's here. That's home. That's us. On it, everyone you love, everyone you know, everyone you ever heard of, every human being who ever was, lived out their lives. The aggregate of our joy and suffering. Thousands of confident religions, ideologies, and economic doctrines. Every hunter and forager, every hero and coward, every creator and destroyer of civilization. Every king and peasant, every young couple in love, every mother and father, hopeful child, inventor and explorer, every teacher of morals, every corrupt politician, every superstar, every supreme leader, every saint and sinner in the history of our species lived there, on the mote of dust suspended in a sunbeam. The Earth is a very small stage in a vast cosmic arena. Think of the rivers of blood spilled by all those generals and emperors, so that in glory and triumph they could become the momentary masters of a fraction of a dot. Think of the endless cruelties visited by the inhabitants of one corner of this pixel on the scarcely distinguishable inhabitants of some other corner. How frequent their misunderstandings, how eager they are to kill one another, how fervent their hatreds. Our posturings, our imagined self-importance, the delusion that we have some privileged position in the universe, are challenged by this point of pale light. Our planet is a lonely speck in the great enveloping cosmic dark. In our obscurity, in all this vastness, there is no hint that help will come from elsewhere to save us from ourselves. The Earth is the only world known so far to harbor life. There is nowhere else, at least in the near future, to which our species could migrate. Visit? Yes. Settle? Not yet. Like it or not, for the moment, the Earth is where we make our stand. It has been said that astronomy is a humbling and character-building experience. There is perhaps no better demonstration of the folly of human conceits than this distant image of our tiny world. To me, it underscores our responsibility to deal more kindly with one another and to preserve and cherish the pale blue dot.